Okay. Welcome everyone to the Topos Institute Colloquium. For this talk, please save your questions till the end. Today we have Davide Tratta talking to us about generalized existential completions and applications. So please, Davide.
So thank you very much, David, for the introduction. And I'm very delighted to be here today. And I want to thank all the organizers of this seminar for inviting me to present this talk. So thank you very much. Now, the main purpose of this talk is to present an overview of a series of recent works regarding Lovier doctrines and the quantifier-free elements presented in this language of Lovier doctrines and application, in particular, to the dialectical interpretation. Before starting, I would like to thank all my co-authors, because as I said, this is an overview of some works. In particular, the first part of this talk is based on a joint work with Milly Maietti. So I want to thank Milly for her contribution. And I want to thank also Valeria De Paiva and Matteo Spadetto, because the second part about the applications to the dialectical interpretation is based on the joint works with Valeria and Matteo. So, as I said, the main purpose of this talk is to present existential and universal free elements in this language of Lovier doctrines. In particular, it is easy to see, for example, in logic when a formula is free from an existential quantifier or free from a universal quantifier. We just need to look at the formula and check if there is or not an existential or a universal quantifier. But the problem of presenting this notion in categorical terms is non-trivial. This because it requires to identify a universal property for these notions of quantifier-free formulas. And the main purpose of this part is to introduce such a universal property, identifying elements which are free from an existential quantifier in the language of Lovier doctrines. Then in the second part, I will explain how we can use such a notion to provide a characterization of a free construction that is called a generalized existential completion. Let me quickly recall that this is a construction that I introduced in this paper. And it is a construction that freely adds existential quantifiers to a given doctrine. And well, using this notion, this categorical presentation of existential free elements, we are able to explain and to prove when a given doctrine is an instance of this construction or not. And finally, we will see some applications to the dialectical interpretation. In this last part, we will see why it is crucial to have the possibility of speaking about quantifier-free elements in the language of Lovier doctrines, essentially because if we want to fully abstract all the logical principles involved in the dialectical interpretation, we need to be able to formally state such a principle in the language of Lovier doctrines. And since this principle involves the notion of quantifier-free formulas from a logical perspective, we need to be able to present in categorical terms such a notion. Here at the bottom of the slides, you can find a list of papers. The first two are regards these two points of the presentation, and the last two papers regards, I would say, this last point of the talk. So before starting with all the detail, I would like to make a very short recap with a little bit of history of the notion of hyperdoctrine, essentially because I will use the notion of doctrine and hyperdoctrine along all these talks. So I want just to quickly recall some related notion and providing some references. In particular, the original notion of hyperdoctrine was introduced by Lovier in this paper, and in order to provide a categorical framework for first-order intuitionistic theories. And well, after that, we can find in the literature of categorical logic several generalization or instances or example of such a notion. Here, I list just some of them, but there are a lot of different notions. But for example, we have the notion of tripos, which can be seen as a higher order version of the notion of hyperdoctrine. This notion was introduced by Hyland, Pitt, and Johnston in this paper. And then we have the notion of elementary and existential doctrine, that is a generalization of the notion of hyperdoctrine introduced by Maietti and Rosolini in this paper. And then you can find a series of papers where this notion is employed. And then we have, of course, the, let me say, the proof-relevant version of doctrines that are fibrations. And here there is a standard reference for this categorical instrument. And then there are other notions like coherent doctrines and so on. Now, we will see the full definition of hyperdoctrine in the final part of this paper. Because in the first part, I decided to work in a more general context with using what we call a conjunctive doctrine. A conjunctive doctrine is a very simple functor. It is just a functor from a category, from the opposite of a category, in the category of inf similattices. So it is a very, very simple functor, and there are a lot of examples of functors in categorical logic that can be seen as particular cases of conjunctive doctrines. I decided to present now four examples that will be our running example for today. And of course, the first example of conjunctive doctrine is the subobject functor. In this case, we have a category with finite limits, and we can define a functor that takes an object of this category and sends it into the poset of subobjects of the category. This poset is an inf similattice. We can construct the conjunction and the top element using the finite limits of the category. And we have that the action of this functor on a given arrow of the base is given in this way. The morphism is given by pulling a subobject back along this arrow F. So this is a very simple example of conjunctive doctrine. Now there is another similar functor that is called the weak subobject doctrine, or doctrine of variations, in the paper of Maietti and Rosolini. And in this case, we start with a category with finite limits. And well, the weak subobject functor takes an object A of the category and sends it in the poset reflection of this last category. Again, this is an inf similattice because we can define the conjunction and the top element using the finite limits as before. And the action of this functor on an arrow of the base is defined essentially as for the subobject functor, so using the pullbacks. Now we have a more, let me say, geometric example, that is the case of the so-called localic doctrine. And in this case, we can define a functor starting from a locale in this way. This is essentially the functor represented by this locale that takes a set and sends it into the poset whose elements are functions from this set into the locale. And the order is, of course, given by the order of the pointwise order. It is given by the order of the locale. And this is another simple example of functor that can be seen as a conjunctive doctrine. Now I want to present, to recall, a syntactic example that I think that it is important to give you an idea of what is the logical meaning of a doctrine and what is the intuition behind these functors. So we can start, for example, with the so-called regular fragment of first-order intuitionistic logic, that is the fragment given by the existential quantifier, the quality, and the conjunction, and the top. And we can define a conjunctive doctrine in this way. We have a functor from the category, which is essentially the category whose objects are lists of variables, so finite lists of variables. And the arrows are essentially substitutions. I mean, an arrow from a finite list of this kind into a final list of this kind is given by a list of terms built in this language, where the length of this list is given by the length of the codomain, and all these terms are in the context given by the domain. The composition in this category is given essentially by the substitution. So this is the base category of our doctrine. And now we need to define a functor. And in this case, we can define a functor that takes a finite list of variables and sends it into the POSIT whose elements are formulas in that context. So whose free variables live in this context. And the order is given in this way. We will say that a formula is less or equal to another one if, assuming the first, we can prove the second. This is, of course, a pre-order, and then we need to take the quotient to obtain a POSIT. So the reason why we use this name is that this is the so-called Lindenbaum-Tarski algebra. So we use this acronym for this functor. And here, you can see what is the logical intuition, what is the logical meaning of a doctrine. It can be seen as a general, as a categorification or as of a fragment of first order intuitionistic logic. So this, I think that it is very important to have a logical intuition of what these functors are. And now, with these examples in mind, I want to introduce now the notion of existential doctrines. So I want to add the existential quantifier to a given doctrine. But I want to do this in a, I want to consider existential quantifiers in a more general context. Usually, and this was the crucial intuition of Lovier, well, we have that the logical existential quantifier is represented in the language of Lovier doctrines as a left adjoint along a projection. But for today, we need to work in a more general context. So I want to consider left adjoint along morphisms, which let me informally say that looks like projection, that can be seen as abstract projections. And to this purpose, before introducing the formal definition of generalized existential doctrine, I need to fix the notation introducing the notion of left class of morphisms, which can be seen essentially as a class of displane maps in some sense. These are essentially generalized projections. So, for today, a left class of morphisms for a given category will be a class such that for it is closed under composition. So if we have two arrows of this class, we have that the composition is again an arrow of this class. And we have that pullbacks of arrows in this class exist for every arrow of the category, and they are again arrow of the class. And finally, we require that every isomorphism is an arrow of this class. For example, projections or monomorphisms form a left class of morphisms, or if we have a category with finite limits, the class of all morphisms is in particular a left class of morphisms. And so this is, in some sense, a generalization. We are generalizing the properties of projections that we need to speak about left adjoints in a suitable way. Now, given a conjunctive doctrine and a left class of morphism of the base, we will say that the doctrine is lambda existential, so it is existential with respect to this class of morphism, if for every arrow of this class, the functor, I'm using this notation to denote the functor obtained by applying the doctrine to the arrow F. We want that this functor has left adjoint, a left, and this satisfies the Beck-Chevalier condition and Frobenius reciprocity. These two conditions are two technical conditions that I don't want to recall all the detail, but I want just to give you an intuition of what is the Beck-Chevalier condition. Essentially, this condition means that the existential quantifier commutes in the correct way with the substitution from a logical perspective. And Frobenius reciprocity essentially means that the left adjoints along a morphism interact well with the reindexing along that morphism and the conjunction. So the idea is that a land existential doctrine is a generalization of the ordinary notion of existential doctrine. When the class is, now I want to fix the notation for the rest of this talk, and then we say that when we consider a class, the class of product projection, well, we will speak about pure existential doctrines. While when the class is the class of all the morphisms of the base, we will speak about full existential doctrines. So these are two particular cases that are relevant for us. So I decided to fix the notation here. Now some examples. The subobject functor, when the category has just finite limit, is not it has no left adjoint along arbitrary morphism, but it has left adjoint along the class of monomorphism. And in this case, left adjoints are given by taking the composition of two subobjects. Similarly, we have that the weak subobject is a full existential, and we can again define the left adjoints by taking the composition of two arrows. The localic doctrine, again, is full existential, and in this case, one can define the left adjoints using the arbitrary disjunction. And finally, we have that the syntactic doctrine associated with the regular fragment of first-order logic is pure existential. And in this case, we have that the existential quantifier along projections is exactly is given by the ordinary existential quantifier in logic. And this is the reason why we use this notation for left adjoints along in a doctrine, because they can be seen as a generalization of this fact. Now I want to introduce in this setting of generalized existential doctrine the notion of existential free elements. As I said before, in logic it is very simple, but in category theory we have to identify a suitable universal property, and we do this in two steps. In the first part, we will say that an object is land existential splitting with respect to, again, we have a left class of morphism and a land existential doctrine. So we will say that an object of this fiber is land existential splitting if whenever beta can be written as an existential quantifier along an arrow of the class of an object, then there exists an arrow that can be seen as a witness of this existential quantifier, such that this composition is the identity and beta is equal to this object. So the idea is that beta is land existential splitting if every time that beta is equal to an existential quantifier, we have a witness and we can remove the existential quantifier and applying this substitution with the witness. But again, this is not enough to fully abstract the notion of existential free element in logic. This because existential free elements in logic have another property, that is for the stability under substitution, right? It is simple, it is very easy to see that if a formula is free from an existential quantifier, if we apply a substitution, then the new formula is again free from the existential quantifier. So we need, in some sense, being free from the existential quantifier in logic is stable under substitution. So we need to add an extra condition by requiring that the stability under reindexing for properly categorify this notion. And we will say that an object is land existential free if for every reindexing of this object, we obtain an object which is a land existential splitting. So in this way, we can abstract all the properties. Let me say, let me informally say that in this way, we can abstract all the properties in this categorical setting. And now we can see some examples. In the case of the subobject doctrine, we have that the elements which are existential free with respect to the class of monomorphisms are exactly given by the identity arrows. And this is the same for the weak subobject doctrine with respect to the class of all the morphisms of the base. The identity arrows are the only elements which are full existential free for this doctrine and mono-existential free for this doctrine. In this example, in the case of the localic doctrine, we have that a full existential free element is exactly a function from a given set to the locale such that every element is super compact in the usual sense. This element satisfies this property. Whenever this is less or equal to a disjunction, we can find an index such that this element is less or equal to this one. So this is a geometric way of thinking about existential free elements. And now there is, of course, the case of the syntactic doctrine. In this case, we have that the pure existential free elements are exactly given by those formulae which are free from the existential quantifier. So we have different interpretation of this notion depending on the case. Here we have a clear geometric interpretation of this notion, and this is the syntactic one. Now I want to introduce another notion in this categorical setting of land existential doctrine, that is the notion of having enough land existential free elements. The idea is that a doctrine, which is land existential, has enough land existential free objects if every object can be written as an existential quantifier along an arrow of the class of an element that is land existential free. For those of you who are familiar with the, for example, with the characterization of the regular completion, this is exactly as of this is similar to the notion of having enough projective objects for a regular category. The idea is the same. We have that a land existential doctrine as enough land existential free element if every element can be written as an existential quantifier of an object which is land existential free, as in the case of the notion of having enough regular projective, for example. Again, here we have some examples. We have that the subobject doctrine has enough mono-existential free objects. This because the left adjoints acts by taking the composition of two arrows. And of course, every subobject can be written as the existential quantifier along itself of the identity that is land existential free. And in we have a similar result for the weak subobject doctrine. In this case, we have that this doctrine has enough full existential free elements. For the same reason, every arrow can be written as an existential quantifier of itself applied to the identity. And here we have the case of the syntactic doctrine that again has enough pure existential free objects. Now, as I said before, these notions are very useful because they allow us to characterize a free construction that is called the generalized existential completion of a doctrine. I introduced this construction in this paper, and we provide a characterization in this paper with Mili Maietti. And well, the idea is that given a conjunctive doctrine and a left class of morphism, we can freely add left adjoints along the arrow of this class, obtaining a new Landeb existential doctrine that we denoted in this way. This construction is a free construction. We can formalize this as a suitable functor between suitable two categories, and we can prove that this is a left adjoint to the forgetful functor, but I don't want to recall all the detail. I want just to recall the fact that we have a construction that freely adds left adjoints along a class of morphisms. Again, I want to fix the notation saying that in the case the category has finite limit and we apply the construction with respect to the class of all the morphisms, we will speak about full existential completion. And while we speak about pure existential completion, when we consider a category with finite products and we freely add left adjoints along this class of product projections. Now, using the notion of Landeb existential free elements and the notion of having enough Landeb existential free objects, we are able to characterize those doctrines which are obtained as instances of this construction. In particular, if we consider a Landeb existential doctrine, we have that this doctrine is a generalized existential completion with respect to this class of some conjunctive doctrine, if and only if P satisfies the following points. First of all, we require that P has enough Landeb existential free objects. Then the P must satisfy the Landa rule of choice, which means that the top element of a fiber is a Landa existential free object. And then we require that Landa existential free elements are closed with respect to binary conjunction. Again, this may remind you the characterization of the regular completion of a Lex category of Carboni in terms of having enough projective. In particular, the characterization says that a regular category is an instance of the regular completion of a Lex category if and only if it has enough regular projective objects, and these are closed with respect to finite limits. So these three conditions are quite similar to that in the case of the regular completion. Now, some examples of doctrines that are generalized existential completions. We have that the subobject doctrine is the generalized existential completion along the class of monomorphisms of the trivial doctrine, that is the doctrine sending that takes an object of the category and sends it into the trivial posit, so the posit with just one element. And similarly, we have that the weak subobject doctrine is isomorphic to the full existential completion of this trivial doctrine. The syntactic doctrine associated with the regular fragment of first order intuitionistic logic is the pure existential completion of the syntactic doctrine associated with the Horn fragment of first order intuitionistic logic, that is the fragment with the quality, the conjunction and the top element. And finally, we proved that the localic doctrine is a full existential completion if and only if the locale is supercoherent. So these are examples of doctrine arising as instances of this construction. Now I want to show you two more examples. I don't want to provide all the detail, but I want just to mention this example. Well, we have that we can use this our characterization to prove that a doctrine that is equipped with the Hilbert's epsilon operator, which means that for every object alpha, we have a witness, an arrow of the base, such that this existential quantifier can be written in this way? Well, we can prove using our characterization that a doctrine is equipped with Hilbert's epsilon operators if and only if it is isomorphic to the existential to the pure existential completion of itself. A last example. Again, I don't want to recall all the detail, but this is a relevant example, so I want at least to mention the result, and in case we will come back later on this. We can prove that every doctrine associated with a partial combinatory algebra, so every realizability doctrine, is an instance of the full existential completion. And in particular, it is the full existential completion of its sub-doctrine of singletons, which are essentially functions from a set to the PCA. But this is just, I don't want to recall all the detail of this doctrine. I want just to mention the result, which is important because this is a relevant class of doctrine, which is well known and studied. Now, I want to show some applications to the dialectical interpretation, which is the last part of this talk. And before starting with all the detail, I want to make a very short recap about the dialectical interpretation. I want just to recall the main features of this translation and what are the motivations. So, essentially, Gödel's dialectical interpretation is an interpretation of intuitionistic arithmetic in a quantifier-free theory of functionals of finite type that is called a system T. And the idea is that we have to translate every formula of the intuitionistic arithmetic to a formula with this specific form. So that is an existential quantifier of a universal quantifier of a formula which is quantifier-free. And the application is essentially of this translation is to obtain a proof of consistency of the arithmetics, of the intuitionistic arithmetic. In this way, this is a relative consistency result. And this means that if we can prove a statement in the intuitionistic arithmetic, then system T proves this, where this is a string of variables for functional of finite type, and T is a suitable sequence of terms. So the application is this, to prove the relative consistency of the intuitionistic arithmetic. And the goal is to be as constructive as possible in this translation. Now, again, I don't want to recall all the detail, but at least I want to recall the most complicated point of this translation, that is the interpretation of the implication. In particular, we have that this formula is interpreted in this complicated way, where this essentially this function plays the role of a witness function. This can be seen as a counterexample function, and essentially this translation of the implication involves three logical principles that are the principle of independence of premise, a generalization of Markov principle, and the axiom of choice, or the principle of scolemization. And well, this over the years, we can find several works that providing categorification of this interpretation. In particular, I want to recall the notion of dialectical category introduced by Valeria De Paiva in her PhD thesis. And then we can find other works by Island, Hofstra, and Behring, where this interpretation is presented in terms of vibrations. But now I want just to explain a crucial difference between our approach and the traditional one. Well, usually the idea is that a dialectical category is a category where the arrows abstract the way the dialectical interpretation acts on the implication. And this is the same for the vibrational version of the dialectical construction. Now, I want to introduce the notion of Gödel doctrine, which wants to provide a categorification of the dialectical interpretation, but our perspective is quite different. The idea is that we didn't focus on the interpretation of the implication, but we focus on the principles, on the other logical features of the dialectical interpretation, and then we will obtain the correct interpretation of the implication as a corollary of our main results. And of course, our notion is, we proved that the notion that I will present in the following slide is really equivalent to the ordinary presentation of, for example, the dialectical fibration and so on. But the way we present it allows us to easily prove that these principles are satisfied. So the focus is on the logical feature of the dialectical interpretation, which are these three logical principles. Now, in order to present this doctrine, and in particular, in order to speak about the principle of independence of premise and the Markov principle and the principle of scholemization or the axiom of choice, I need to introduce the notion of first order hyperdoctrine, because we need that our fibers, well, we need the eating structure of our fiber to fully express categorically all the logical principles. So let me recall that the first order hyperdoctrine is a functor from a category with finite products into the category of eating algebras, satisfying, well, we have that for every projection, this morphism has a left adjoint denoted in this way as before, this is a pure existential doctrine, and a right adjoint. And again, we require that these satisfy the Beck-Chevalley condition. Moreover, we require that for every object A, there exists a predicate that can be seen as an equality predicate satisfying this condition for every object alpha. The idea is that this element represents the equality predicate. Now, we will say that a first order hyperdoctrine is a Gödel hyperdoctrine if it satisfies these four points. First of all, we need to require that the base category is Cartesian closed. Then the doctrine P has enough pure existential free predicates. The pure existential free objects are stable under universal quantification. That means that if alpha is existential free, then this object is again pure existential free. Again, from a logical perspective, this is quite natural, because if a formula is free from a universal quantifier, from an existential quantifier, if we apply the universal quantifier to this formula, we obtain again a formula that is free from the existential quantifier. And finally, we require that the sub-doctrine, whose elements are just the pure existential free elements of P, well, we want that this doctrine has enough pure universal free predicates. So this is our notion of Gödel hyperdoctrine. You can find all the detail here, and in particular in this paper, we proved that this notion is really equivalent to the ordinary presentation of the dialectica construction for the fibrational case. And well, the crucial point is that in these doctrines, we are able to formally say that an element is quantifier free. And in particular, we can say that an element of a fiber is quantifier free when it is existential free and it is universal free in the sub-doctrine of existential free elements. Now, I didn't recall the dual version of the notion of existential free element, because it is straightforward to dualize the definition of existential free element obtaining the definition of universal free element, but it is one can easily dualized definition of obtaining a suitable notion for universal free predicates. And well, using this notion, we can combining these two notions, we can define an we can understand when an object is quantifier free in a Gödel doctrine. Now, for the rest of this talk, I will use this notation. So let me say the internal language of a doctrine to present all our result, because you will see that this way of presenting the elements of a doctrine is more close to the ordinary logical way of presenting these formulas. And the idea is that we will write in this way, instead of writing that this formula is less or equal to this one in this fiber. And similarly, we will use the logical notation for the existential quantifier and the universal quantifier instead of this. Now, using the notion of Gödel hyperdoctrine, we are able to prove that essentially these doctrines satisfy the principal logical features of the dialectical interpretation. In particular, the first one is a sort of Prenex normal presentation for the elements, which means that in a Gödel hyperdoctrine, every element can be written as an existential quantifier of a universal quantifier of an element that is quantifier free. Then, we have that every Gödel hyperdoctrine satisfies the axiom of choice or this principle of schlemmization. So we have that for every Gödel hyperdoctrine, we have that the principle of schlemmization or the axiom of choice, because this can be seen as a choice function, is satisfied. So we have that at least the first two features of the dialectical interpretation are satisfied by every Gödel hyperdoctrine, which are this sort of Prenex normal presentation of the elements of a doctrine and the principle of schlemmization or the axiom of choice. Now, we want to show that we want to understand if a Gödel hyperdoctrine satisfies also the principle of Markov and the principle of independence of premise. And in particular, what we proved in this paper is that every Gödel doctrine satisfies the rule version of the independence of premise. That is, whenever this formula, where alpha is an existential free predicate, whenever this formula is true, then we have that also this one is true. To obtain the usual principle of independence of premise and not just the rule presentation of this principle, we need to require that existential free predicates are closed with respect to finite conjunctions. Under this assumption, we have that Gödel hyperdoctrine satisfies the ordinary principle of independence of premise. And again, notice that here we need to be able to say that a formula is existential free to properly state the logical principle in this categorical framework. Then we focus on the modified version of Markov principle. In particular, we prove that every Gödel hyperdoctrine satisfies the following modified Markov rule. And it is the case that when this beta is a quantifier-free predicate, and alpha is existential-free, then if this formula is true, then we can prove this one. To obtain the principal version of this rule, we need to require that existential-free predicates are closed with respect to implication. Under this assumption, we can prove that the doctrine, a Gödel hyperdoctrine, satisfies this principle that we call modified Markov principle. We call this modified Markov principle because we can then obtain the generalized version of the principle of Markov principle as corollary of this result. In particular, we have that every Gödel hyperdoctrine, where this, where the bottom is a quantifier-free element, satisfies this Markov rule. And under the assumption that existential free predicates are closed with respect to implication, we have that the doctrine satisfies also the principle of the Markov principle presented in this way. So here you can see that it is crucial to have the possibility of saying that an element is quantifier-free in a doctrine, because we need this to properly state the principles that are involved in the dialectica interpretation. And then we can prove our main result, that is, well, we have seen that that a Gödel hyperdoctrine satisfies all the logical principles involved in the dialectical interpretation. And then using this result, we obtain as application of this theorem that in a Gödel hyperdoctrine satisfies the assumptions that we saw before. So we require that existential free predicates are closed with respect to implication and finite conjunctions, and that the bottom is quantifier free. Then these two formulas are probably equivalent. And this means exactly that in this setting, the implication is interpreted in the correct way, because we obtain exactly the equivalence that we had at the beginning, where I introduced the interpretation of the implication in the dialectica translation. So all these results are presented in this paper. And I want just to conclude by showing some future work and some other applications of this notion. In particular, we are using the notion of existential free elements to provide a characterization of regular and the exact completions of Lovere doctrines with Mili-Majetti. We are using this notion also to provide to abstract the sharpification as tripos to topos adjunction. And then we can apply this notion also to abstract the notion of supercompact element to the so-called implicative algebras introduced by Mikel, and to characterize the assemblies arising from implicative triposes. And finally, we can use this notion to provide a categorification of some notions regarding computability, like Medvedev reducibility, Muchnik reducibility, or Weierstrass reducibility. So this is just to show some other applications of these instruments in other settings. And with these slides, I think that I have finished the time. So I want to thank all of you for your attention.
Thank you, Davide. So are there questions? If you have a question, feel free to just unmute yourself and ask, or you can raise your hand if you prefer.
Okay, I'll go. Thanks a lot, Davide. That was really nice. Can I go way back to the categorical definition of existential free predicates and ask whether you can give an idea of why in the regular logic hyperdoctrine, the existential free guys in your sense are actual existential free formulas?
So, okay. Here, so are you speaking about this example, right?
Exactly, okay. Yeah.
The idea is that if you consider the regular fragment of first order logic, this is of course the best existential extension of the fragment of logic given by the quality, top element, and conjunction. So this, the regular fragment of first order intuitionistic logic, can be seen as the best existential extension of the Horn fragment. So we can formally prove that it enjoys, at the level of doctrines, the syntactic doctrine associated with the regular fragment of first order logic is the best existential doctrine extending the syntactic doctrine associated with the Horn fragment of first order intuitionistic logic. So we can prove that this doctrine is the existential completion, the pure existential completion of the syntactic doctrine associated with the Horn fragment, because it is from a syntactic point of view, it is the best extension. And now we can use our main theorem to prove that, okay, so we know that the syntactic doctrine associated with the regular fragment is the pure existential completion of the doctrine associated with the Horn fragment. And employing our characterization, we can prove that these are exactly the predicates which are quantifier-free, existential-free. This is the idea of the proof. Okay, because so from a syntactic point of view, it is the best extension of the Horn fragment with the existential quantifier.
Great, that helps a lot. Thank you.
If I may add, this is just an algebraic proof.
You're seeing comment or a question? A comment, yeah?
Comment on this, basically, just add a comment. This is a pure algebraic proof of a syntactical result that usually is proved with the normal form theorem of natural deduction or character elimination with the sequence calculus. And here is a pure algebraic proof of the fact that the existential free formulas are the one without the existential quantification. So it's nice. I liked it.
That's certainly really nice for me. Thanks.
Yes.
Hey, hi, David. You know, I mispronounced your name, but you miswrote my name all over, you know. Did you notice that you kind of, you probably haven't noticed, but you know, my name is wrong all the way through. but that's not important. It's just what I was kind of wanting to say is that I think there is another bit of work that we haven't done yet that I'm trying to convince you to do, which is to actually, go back to the main theorem again, please, of the application, the main theorem on the dialectica. Right. You see, I think what we wanted to do still is to show this business of what are the existential free predicates that are close with respect to implication, and what are the finite conjunctions, and how to show it. And we also want to show that falsehood, this bottom, is quantifier free in a very constructive, because our result is a general one. Whenever these things happen, then we have this equivalence between the implication of dialectical formulas and the notion of functionals that Gödel constructed. But you know, I think we still want to show specific constructions where that actually happens, and what kind of something that is not completely syntactic, like ours is, I think.
Yes, of course. We have, in this moment, we have just some syntactic examples, for example, doctrines equipped with Hilbert, Epsilon, and Tau operators that satisfies all our properties. But of course, we want to find more concrete models and doctrines satisfying all the properties that we need.
Oh, great, you're committing to doing it. That's great, wonderful. Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Okay, thank you. Millie, do you have another question or comment? Yes.
Thank you very much, Davide. And I wanted to ask you about the conditions to define a Gödel-Lepe doctrine. If you could rephrase it by in terms of the existential, the universal completion, by
yes.
About preservation of connectives.
Okay. In general, we know that
in an equivalent way, you could rephrase it in a more you can memorize it by.
Yes, the idea
about
is
preservation.
That. Yes, the idea is that in general, we define for a doctrine whose fibers are just posets. A Gödel doctrine in this more general sense can be proved to be an instance of the existential and universal completion. So this is essentially, Hofstra was the first who observed this, who proved this result for the fibrational version. And then we use this presentation to provide an intrinsic description of dialectical doctrines in terms of quantifier free elements. So yes, the point is that we need to require, for example, that the base category is Cartesian closed, because since we first apply the universal completion and then the existential, in order to preserve the universal quantifier, we need that the base category is Cartesian closed. And then this four condition can be presented in terms of universal and existential completion by saying that P is an instance of the existential completion of a universal completion.
When you preserve the universal quantifications.
Yes.
Yeah, because in the mind you could remember this as a more, and then unraveling the definition with the other, because it's easier to remember the observation.
Yes.
Just a comment.
Yes. No, of course this is a very simple presentation, but this explicit description is useful to prove the validity of the result. But from an abstract perspective, we can equivalently say that this is an instance of the existential completion of a universal completion
with the preservation of the quantifiers,
which is guaranteed by the fact that C is Cartesian closed.
And also then later about the implication and the fulsum, isn't it? At the end.
No, this in general is not the implication in general is not preserved by all
these.
Yeah, no,
but then you strengthen it. Okay. And do you think that the topos is satisfying epsilon and tau?
And tau.
Are examples of this?
Yes, they are examples. Yes, because we can.
They are not the syntactic ones. So we have examples. The one
maybe the topos is with the epsilon and tau. We need to require also the tau operator.
I think they should exist then.
Examples are not syntactic.
Yes, thank you.
Okay, thanks for the questions. I think let's stop here and thank Davide again. Thank you.
Thank you very much.